गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग। सो यस्टरडे वी कंप्लीटेड इंक ब्लॉट टेस्ट। इन दैट वी डिड रोशार्क एंड होल्ट्जमैन। टुडे वील कंप्लीट दिस चैप्टर एंड देन वील गो टू यूनिट वन ऑफ ब्लॉक टू। सो इन दिस वी हैव टीएटी, दैट इज द अपरसेप्शन टेस्ट दैट इज रिमेनिंग, द सेंटेंस कंप्लीशन टेस्ट, limitations of projective test and all about personality inventory. So under the apperception test, what exactly is apperception test? It is projecting your perceptions on some stimulus which may not be as ambiguous as it was in ink blot, but there might be certain stimulus which you are not aware of about in what context are they set, and it is you who has to construct a story around it. Okay, so under that we have many kinds of apperception test, like thematic apperception test is the most common. Apart from that, you have senior apperception test, children apperception test. Okay, so let us, since we have only the TAT to cover here, we'll talk about the TAT. So TAT is the thematic apperception test. It has 20 pictures which are all black and white. Okay, and the people in this picture are drawn in ambiguous situations. So what happens is the once that picture is shown, the subject is asked to actually construct a story around it and to tell what exactly is happening in the picture, what are the causes that has led to this, and what could have happened in the past, what will happen in the future. So basically the subject is asked to form a continuous flow of events. Okay, and then whatever the story the subject narrates, that is interpreted by the psychologist who tries to look for hidden elements or hidden emotions in the characters of the pictures. Okay, so the examiner first sees who is the protagonist or who is the hero in the story, and also the experimenter also see what are the various motives, or let's say what are the various things that are coming out through this story. So it could be like, let's say, achievement, it could be aggression, it could be it could be some wish that the client or the subject had but then was not able to achieve it in his life. Okay, and there is something known as press. So what is a press? So press is those environmental forces that may facilitate or interfere with need satisfaction. So sometimes you know what you want, but let's say you were a very good, you were a very good player and you wanted to play for the district level or for the state level, and your achievement would have been to be counted as a state level player, but the environment was such, maybe your parents or your the people around you were not very supporting, or maybe you did not have enough resources to reach there. So all this is called as a press. Okay. So,
Sorry, can you tell me which chapter are we doing? I mean, which page?
48, page 48. Wherever we left yesterday, we are just starting from there.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Okay. So, now TAT is very common. It's also used in the curriculum of many of the colleges these days, university these days. We use this in practicals also. So you'll come across this very often. Okay, and also it's used in clinical settings, because while the person is making the story or uttering the story, sometimes he goes through a lot of emotions. So whenever you see he is pausing at a particular place, or he's taking, he's showing some delayed reaction, he's showing some, facial expressions of guilt, happiness, etc., then you would know that these are a few things that are actually affecting him. Okay. So this was about the thematic apperception test. Then we have the sentence completion test. So this is also this is also a type of projective technique where you are asked to complete a sentence. So, you might have sentences like, I wish I could, and then there would be nothing else. So you'll have to write it down. You'll have to complete it. Okay. Now there are varieties of sentence completion. Somewhere you just need to speak somewhere you need to actually write it down. Okay, so it will just show what is in your mind. Okay, it is all about the unconscious and the repressed things that are in your mind. Then there is a draw a person test where you will be asked to draw a person. Let's say somebody who influences you in your life, you'd have to draw that person. You don't have to be very good in drawing. We'll just see that whether the head is very large or how are the limbs, how is the torso. If you are drawing a very tall person, that will have different interpretation. This is how, you know, that is a draw a man test. Okay. Now, sometimes there are word association tests also. I will speak out few words and the very next word that comes to your mind, you have to utter that. Suppose I'll tell, what do you understand by bucket? So somebody would say, I can relate water to it. So somebody would say, I relate clothes to it. Okay. And somebody would say, I relate paint to it, paint. Okay. So similarly, word association is also a type of projective techniques. So projective techniques are good when you want to bring out the repressed material to the forefront. But there are some limitations of projective test also. The number one limitation would be that the reliability and validity, always the problem of reliability and validity always exists in projective tests. Also, there are very less projective tests which are standardized over a large population. Okay, and then next is interpreter, or you can say the examiner has to be very trained. Also, no two examiner would have the same interpretation on a same response set. Okay, on a same answers given by a subject. So that can also affect the quality. Then some situational variables like the examiner's physical characteristics. That might influence the responses on projective techniques. The person who is on whom we have applied the projective techniques, or who is giving the test under projective techniques, sometimes his mood, or let's say his degree of irritableness, his degree of agreeableness, etc., that could also hamper his responses. Okay, and lastly. Projective techniques suffer from empirical evidences. You cannot replicate a projective technique even on the same person and get the same answer, because sometimes a person who has constructed a story or a person who has given a response for ink blot now, even after you ask him after, if you ask him after 2-3 months, zaruri nahi hai that he will give the same response. That time the ink blots may appear as some different design to him. Okay, so that is why they have very less chance of replicability. And also globally, as per culture also, this will change. Okay, but one good thing about projective techniques is very less language is used in the stimulus or in the presentation. So the person is encouraged to speak more, so we can know more about the subject. It is more of a subject-centric test. So after this, we come to behavioral assessment. So what is behavioral assessment? Behavioral assessment is where we are trying to understand and measure a person's behavior. Or basically, we are trying to evaluate how a person's behavior is. Now, why is psychology or why is behavioral assessment important? Because if we can if we can assess the behavior correctly, then we can describe the behavior, we can control the behavior, we can modify the behavior, and we can also predict the behavior. So for these four reasons, behavioral assessment is very useful to us, and also it forms the basis of many therapies. It forms the basis of many modification techniques. We can try to make a person learn, unlearn, and also relearn. Okay. The various socially acceptable behaviors, also those behaviors that make a person internally happy. So sometimes you don't want to behave in a particular way, but you do so because you think what others will think about me, and later you regret that why did you behave like that? It was against your principles. It was against a very common example is although I have come across this that especially children who are from very traditional homes, when they go and they join, let's say they join a company out of their hometown, out of their state, and then they have these parties, and you know, for peer pressure, you know, they are asked to drink or smoke, and they do it because otherwise they'll seem less fashionable in their own terms, in their own words. But after they do it, they feel very guilty. They don't feel very happy. So we have to, in here, the best behavior modification technique will be how to teach them how to be assertive. Okay. So similarly, we can only do this when we can measure behavior properly. And how can we measure behavior properly? If we can do that if we directly observe the behavior. Okay. Or let's say we are conducting any research and we are trying to find out how the person behaves in certain situations. If we are talking to them, we can know through interview, through survey. Okay. Also, if we are asking them to do some role play in certain situations also, we can know what a person, what kind of behavior a person will display. Okay, so this is all about behavioral assessment, although there are some limitations of behavioral assessment also. So one is the observer bias, and second is we do not have any control over the external environment, and sometimes this may lead to wrong interpretation, or we might interpret in a particular direction and that might not be helpful for us. Then we have personality inventory. We had talked about few in the last class only. So personality inventory is you have a lot of questions related to your personality, and you have to mark them as yes, no, can't say, or strongly agree, disagree. These kind of questions you will have. They're basically closed-ended questions. You'll hardly get open-ended questions in personality inventories. You'll never have any question, but as a starting, just in the beginning of the test, you'll have one or two just to open you up with the theme of the entire inventory. So we had talked about Kettle 16 PF. We had also talked about NEO-PIR in the previous class. Then we have Myers-Briggs type indicator that we had talked about, where we are having four parameters which are in a continuum, okay, like thinking, feeling, extroversion, introversion, perceiving, judging, okay, sensing, intuition. So this was about the Myers-Briggs, okay. We will be taking up NEO-PIR again in considerable detail when we do it in block 4. Then next we have the MMPI-2, or the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory. So as the name suggests, this is a personality inventory. Okay, it's also very common these days. You will find it being used a lot in clinical settings these days. Okay. So it basically tests deviant behavior, and if there is any abnormality in behavior, it's a very long inventory. It consists about 567 statements, and some of the statements also they have given here. I believe I'm being plotted against. I believe people don't like me. I feel that somebody is looking at me. People are discussing about me behind my back. Okay, these kind of statements you have, and then the options that you have is true, false, and cannot say. Okay, so it has 10 clinical scales and 8 validity scales, and there are many subscales. So subscales only the person, the examiner would know the subscales. If the subject cannot know the subscales. These are clustered questions put under various categories. Okay, so again, ranging from mild to more serious disorders such as schizophrenia and depression, this inventory tries to assess. Okay, these behaviors. Okay, now other than MMPI, there are other personality inventories also, sometimes used in educational settings also. Okay, there are some tests used in educational settings also. Suppose a child is very confused as to what discipline or what study he should pursue after his 10th or 12th, basically after 10th. So we have tests for that also. Okay, should we take science? Should we take art? Should we take commerce? Let's say something else. So we have a lot of tests and inventories these days. Okay, now there are some limitations of personality inventories too. There can be, once you are restricting the questions into yes, no, cannot say, you are also restricting the behavior and thinking pattern. Now, I have, suppose I have a question that I think people are discussing behind my back. Yes, no, cannot say. Now, I might feel that people are discussing behind my back, but sometimes I also feel good because that gives me some attention. Okay, there are people who actually feel good about it, that people are discussing about them. Now, this angle of thought cannot be assessed by this personality inventory, which has put it into a closed-ended question. Okay, so therefore, you are actually restricting the a behavior that should have been assessed or that we could have seen. Okay, sometimes the answers, people fake the answers. Okay, people don't want that. People think that, oh God, I'll not look good if I write a yes to it. So let me just write a no or cannot say. Sometimes people feel play very safe and they always lie in the middle of the, you know, they always lie in the mid range. They do not go to answer anything on the extremes. So they would not say a yes or no. Suppose there is a question on parents. I don't like my mother, or let's say I don't like my father, or maybe this is one thing about my mother that irritates me. Now they don't want to write a yes or even a no to it, because they don't want to give a yes because that would make them look bad. They don't want to give a no because they know yet somewhere it does, you know, hurt them, and they really are irritated of that one trait of their parent. So what would they do is they would write a cannot say. Okay, so it's very tough at this point to actually then understand the person's behavior. Okay, also sometimes the language can be a little confusing for some people. Okay, so that also could affect their responses. Okay, so these are some of the issues in personality inventories. So this was all about this chapter. We have finished this chapter. Also, we have finished the block. Please go through it. And next, we will start block 2, unit 1, that is psychodynamic theory. We will try to complete Freud and Karen Horney today. If we don't complete Horney, at least we will start Horney, and then tomorrow we'll take up Sullivan. Okay, just give me 1 minute. I'll just drink water and come, and then we'll start. This is block 2, unit 1, that we'll start. Okay, so we'll start unit 1 of block 2. Before we start, let me tell you a few things. This entire block is the main foundation of the subject psychology. If you are thorough with this entire block, then it will be very easy for you to understand the concepts of psychology, how the personality of a person. It is very helpful in clinical psychology, very helpful for counseling psychology as well, because these are just not theories. They are again the building blocks of therapies that we will deal with later if we are getting into psychology or psychotherapies or counseling, etc. So this is a very, very important block. So even after you have completed your IGNO exams, if you have time, please go through this block once, twice, as many times as you can, because it's very, very important. Also, you can always look up terms from internet and other books and supplement with this, because in your practice, if at all you're going to practice later, let's say, It's going to be very helpful. Okay. So first we'll start with the psychodynamic theory. Before we start the psychodynamic theory, let us just have a small introduction to this theory. First of all, there are two words, psychoanalysis and psychodynamic. Psychoanalysis is a field of study, or let's say is a theory that was developed by a person known as Sigmund Freud. Okay. So it's written as F-R-E-U-D and pronounced as Freud. So Sigmund Freud, he is the main, you can say, creator, developer, or originator of the psychoanalytic theory or the psychoanalysis. Now, psychoanalysis is both a theory and is also a therapy. So whenever we say psychoanalysis, looking at the context, you can understand whether we are talking about the theory or we are talking about the therapy. Now, after Freud, after he developed this theory, he had developed it in a very, you can say, in a very restrictive environment. Again, at a time when talking about sexual or you can say aggression, etc., was not very common. Okay, you will still till today also you will see people say many of Freud's work have still not been published, because that could have led to huge uproar during that time. Okay. Now, after Freud's death, psychoanalysis was again, this field of psychoanalysis was again continued by many other theorists, students of Freud. And then it no more remained as psychoanalysis. It now became psychodynamic, because the ideas were not fixed with what Freud had done. There were many of his own students, many of his own colleagues, and many others who worked with psychoanalysis, but they had varying opinions about some of the terms and concepts used by Freud. So many criticized it, saying that no, what Freud had said is not entirely correct. So it no more remained a fixed discipline, rather it kept changing. So it was termed as psychodynamic, okay, psychodynamics, psychodynamic theory. And who were these persons? People like Alfred Adler, people like Karen Horney, people like Carl Jung, okay, Sullivan. So these people are very, you can say, very prominent, very influential theorists and supporters of the psychodynamic theory and the psychodynamic movement in general. Okay, so after looking at this introduction, now let us go to what is the psychoanalytic theory in itself. Okay, so psychoanalytic theory, we will segregate them and we'll learn, but try to understand. I'll just tell you the basic, and then while we are segregating, I'll tell you. Just think that your mind is made up of three layers, okay? So actually we do not know where our mind is. For some people it's in your heart, for some people it's in your head. So nobody exactly knows the location of the mind. Like let's assume that it's somewhere in your head. So your mind again is divided into three categories, or let's say three stages. Stages would be much better. Now, whatever is in your awareness, or whatever you are aware of, whatever you know in the present, that is known as the conscious stage. Okay, conscious stage. For example, right now I'm speaking, and right now you're listening. I am aware that I'm talking, and few people are listening to me. You are aware that I'm talking and you are taking down notes, or you are making some notes somewhere on the book somewhere. So this is all happening in the conscious realm, and we are all aware of what is happening. We can understand that this is what is happening in the present time, right now, here. So that is known as the conscious stage. But let's say I'll ask you, what did you have today in your breakfast? What did you have today in your lunch? What color clothes did you wear yesterday? Now, that is not there in your conscious mind. That is not there in your consciousness right now. But with little effort, you can bring it, okay? You can bring it to your conscious level. Like, let's say I'll ask, what did you have in your breakfast? You might take 5 minutes and you will recall and you will tell me. So that is your pre-conscious or subconscious, okay? There are a lot of material in your subconscious which you know, which has already passed, but right now it is not available. You will have to take some time and you have to bring it to the consciousness, okay? That is your pre-conscious or your subconscious. Then the last one is known as the unconscious. What is the unconscious? Unconscious is like a dumping box, okay? You have experienced so much, been exposed to so much, gone through so much, but it's not possible to keep everything in your pre-conscious or your conscious. So what do? You push it inside a box, keep it there, and try to bring it to your consciousness as and when required or if triggered by something. So basically, it's just like your long-term memory. It's somewhere there, okay? You have forgotten that this has happened. Now, how can you know, there will be a question, how can I know it's in my unconscious? Just remember, whatever you have experienced, it will go in your unconscious if you don't pay attention to it or if you don't want it to remain in the consciousness, okay? Now, let's say sometimes you would see, suppose you, as a child, you stayed at, let's say, Nagpur, okay? I'm just giving an example, it's a random example. And then your father, when you were 4 or 5 years old, he shifted to Mumbai, okay? And then after 20 years, you got a chance to go to Nagpur. And then coincidentally, you reached the same locality where you had stayed when you were a child, when you were a 4 or 5 year old child. See, you don't remember now. You really don't remember what that place looked like or, you know, when, which was the year that you had stayed there. But the moment you reach there, you will start feeling a little uneasy. You will start feeling that there is something that you are trying to recollect, but it is not coming up to your conscious realm. Then, if you are spending 4 to 5 minutes there or let's say half an hour there, and you are consciously trying to remember or trying to recollect, then you will feel that, acha, I have seen this place somewhere. I think when I was small, I was, we were staying in this place. This was the locality I was in. Now, what you had done is you had basically taken out the material from your unconscious and you are now putting it in your conscious level. Okay. So this is how the mind is divided into conscious, pre-conscious or subconscious. Pre-conscious and subconscious, the same thing, okay? And unconscious. Please understand, it is just like an iceberg, okay? If you have seen this movie Titanic, because that is where the iceberg was shown very well, the iceberg has just 1/10 of the material which is visible to us above the water. That is just 1/10. The majority, that is 9/10, is underwater. So just like our mind, a very small portion is our conscious. Whatever is the tip of the iceberg is our consciousness. A little beyond that, just below the water, where it is actually touching the water, you can say on the surface, that is our pre-conscious or subconscious. And the majority, the big part, let's say about 8/10 of the majority, bigger part of the iceberg that is underwater, is our unconscious, where we have repressed. Now, there is a difference between repress and suppress. Repress is which you are trying to do deliberately. You have deliberately pushed it into your unconscious because you don't want to bring it to your conscious level. Suppress is you have not forgotten it. It's just that you are not expressing it, okay? Let me give you an example. Suppose your father let's give it in a hypothetical situation. Let's say there's this girl and her father was very very apathetic towards her because he didn't want a girl child in his family, and he has treated her very, very in a very bad or cruel way, you can say, in childhood. Now that time the girl did not like this behavior of her father, but she was unable to tell it on his face. Okay, so that is suppressing. You exactly know what is going through, what you are going through, you exactly know what is happening, but you are not able to express it. Okay, you are not getting that opportunity or chance to express. Now the child has grown up. The father, on the other hand, now is suffering from cancer. The child, she is taking care of her father, but sometimes when she when she was very young, once she had fallen down while riding a cycle, and she looked at her father, but her father never came to pick her up. Okay, and that had hurt the child a lot. Now at this stage, when the father has got cancer, he has accidentally slipped from the bed, and the daughter comes and she picks the father up, and she places him on the bed carefully. Suddenly this memory of being ignored and neglected 20-25 years back flashes in her mind. Okay, so this has come out from the unconscious to the conscious, but that it does not mean that she had it just it does not mean that she's doing it knowingly. The stimulus at that moment had brought up this moment, and she totally had forgotten about this incident. Why? Because it was so troubling for her, it was so hurting for her, she never wanted to remember this. So she might have remembered it for a year, two, maybe in her college, and she had forgotten about it. She had deliberately repressed it. Today, just because the stimulus is similar and the environment is similar, it has somehow come up to the conscious. Okay, so this is what is repression. And suppression is when you know the thing, when you want to say but you cannot say. So just tell me, is this much clear to everybody? Because if this much is clear, then we will have a good grip over psychoanalysis. So I'll just ask individually everybody, because this is a little different from what we have been doing till now. So please, one by one, please tell everybody, is this okay with you? Did you understand till here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. So, okay. Sagar ji, did you understand? Varsha ji, did you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Dindyuti ji, did you understand? Okay. So, okay. Next, we'll go to... Next, we'll have some other concepts of this theory. first of all, there are certain assumptions. So there are certain assumptions this theory has. Okay. So first is that our behavior and feelings are powerfully affected by our unconscious motives. Okay. So we have a lot of motives in mind, but we never bring it to the consciousness. Okay, in school, if you ask children what are the unconscious motives, now they literally hate those teachers who takes their game classes to cover up the courses. Okay, if you'll ever ask them, they'll feel that I just want to hit my teacher, and I want to throw ink at her face, but they'll never do this. Okay, this is what they feel, but these are unconscious. Okay, these are inside their mind. Okay, now, okay, after conscious, unconscious, and after conscious, preconscious, and unconscious, I also want to tell you one more thing. One is the dynamic structure of the mind, where we will talk about the id, ego, and superego. So what are id? So id are basically you can say those wishes, okay, or let's say id are those motives that are there in the person and they seek immediate gratification. Okay, so they basically run on this pleasure principle. So my id wish of mine is right now, let's say, to go to Jammu and Kashmir. This is my id. Okay, I don't know what is the reality. I don't know how I'm going to arrange for the ticket or how I'm going to arrange for my stay there or whatever. But this is my immediate wish that I want to go to the JNK. Okay, and id impulses are those which majority of the times are not socially acceptable. Okay, sometimes you badly want to slap somebody, you badly want to abuse somebody, but you're not able to do it because the situation at that place or the societal restrictions at that place do not allow you to do it. Okay, so id impulses are present at birth, and basically you will see children, they work on this. Okay, immediate gratification, they want something and they want it right now. They work on pleasure principle. Okay, they will not eat karela, but they will eat chocolate. Okay, so whatever gives them happiness. Okay, so this is the id. Whatever wish, you know, you have some wish and you want those wish to be fulfilled right there, right now. And id mein you basically have all those wishes jo ki societal restrictions ke wajah se cannot be done. Like let's say any aggressive urges, any sexual urges, any negative things, any antisocial things, all this comes under id. Then we have something known as the ego. So what does ego do? Ego actually works on the reality principle. So let's say if you are wanting to badly scold somebody, your ego would tell you, see, look, don't get excited, okay? No need to scold him that much, because tomorrow that might go against you. Just tell him in few hard and stern sentences. You don't do any mistake, okay? You be rational. You work on a reality, you work how the reality is. So ego will always control you from doing anything wrong. Okay, ego is basically your conscience. Okay, it is basically your inner voice that is telling you that don't do anything just for the sake of pleasure. Also understand the consequence. Okay, so that is your ego. Then we have something known as the superego. So superego is what? Superego is like a saint, is like the ideal. What would superego tell you in that situation? No, don't scold anybody, because scolding somebody is very wrong. You are nobody to scold, because you are not perfect yourself. You should learn to adjust. You should learn to forgive. You should talk to him peacefully and try to explain him the situation. So superego is always talking about very idealistic things, very saintly things. Id is on the other side of the continuum, which always wants immediate gratification and it wants to do things for his own pleasure. Ego is something that is balancing between both the id and the superego, saying that no, id, we cannot follow you because you are being too harsh and the society does not agree to this. And sorry, superego, we are not even following you, because what you are telling, if this is what you will do, then we'll have people slapping us and kicking us. So we are not even following you. Let's go in the middle path. Let's go in the realistic way. Okay. So this is the id, ego, superego. This is known as the dynamic or structural model. So let us now come to the assumptions. The first assumption is our behavior and feelings are powerfully affected by our unconscious motives, because they keep coming to our conscious realm and they direct our behavior. Second, our behavior and feelings as adults are rooted in our childhood experience. Definitely, whatever you have experienced in your childhood, they form, with that you form a meaning of life around you. And if they are too disturbing or something, you repress them, okay, inside, in your unconscious. Okay. Third is, all behavior have a cause, and all behavior is determined from some effect. True, exactly. You behave in a particular way because of the stimulus around you. Now, personality is made up of three parts. That is the id, ego, superego. I just told you. Behavior is motivated by two instinctual drives, That is the Eros and Thanatos. So what is Eros? Eros is a living force, okay? Everything that you, every constructive ideas, every wish towards living, towards happiness, towards fulfillment, all of this is the Eros. Just the opposite of it is Thanatos. Thanatos is a death wish. Every time if you are thinking about negative things, hurting others, hurting yourself, trying to end something, suffering, pain, miserable, all this is Thanatos, okay? Now, Thanatos and Eros, they are working continuously in our life. It is we who are trying to maintain a balance, okay? So sometimes you want good for yourself, also you want good for others, so this is Eros. Sometimes you want bad for others, and sometimes friends you also want bad for yourself. Kabhi kabhi aap bolte ho na, I don't want to live anymore, I really want to die. Then there are some people who indulge in self-harming behavior. They'll cut their, vein, you know, they'll hurt themselves. These are all Thanatos operating, okay? Now, again, there are two types of energy. One is physical energy and one is psychic energy. So physical energy is that energy which is used for doing physical activities like running, walking, okay, swimming, etc. What is psychic energy? Psychic energy is your mental energy, okay? So all that energy that you use in your thinking, analyzing, logical conclusions, etc., that is your psychic energy. So the source of this psychic energy is known as libido, okay? The term is libido, L-I-B-I-D-O. It is known as libido. Now, libido, where is it? Whether it is visible, invisible, nothing is known about it. It is basically an invisible flow that Freud says is there. And it is this libido that directs our Eros and Thanatos wish, okay? And throughout our life, we are trying to balance the Eros and Thanatos wish, okay? So you will see when you are very happy, you'll always wish good for others too. When you are very sad, you don't care what's happening to the world, who is dying, what is happening. Somebody irritates you that time, you might, hit that person or you might hit yourself out of frustration, okay? So this is the Eros and Thanatos. So exactly what they are saying, that behavior is motivated by two instinctual drives. Eros, that is the sex drive and the life instinct, and Thanatos, that is the aggressive drive and the death instinid. Both these drives come from the id, okay? And the psychic energy that drives these, leads to these two is known as the libido, okay? Now, part of the unconscious mind, that is id and the superego, are in constant conflict with the conscious part of the mind, that is the ego. And personality is shaped as the drives are modified by different conflicts at different times in childhood. That means, at different times, you will face a lot of conflict, okay? In your mind, you will have a lot of conflict. Should I do this? Should I do that? So, basically, personality is shaped by these conflict and you how you overcome these conflict, okay? So, this was the assumption. Now we come to the actual theory. We have not yet come to the actual theory. We'll now come to the actual theory. Now, Sigmund Freud was basically a psychiatrist who at that time, there was something known as, as I told you, the time when he was working with clients or when he was working with subjects, it was a very suppressive time, okay? People were not that free to talk about sex. They were not so much free to talk about aggression, to talk about their id urges, okay? They were very repressed, they were very suppressed, they were very unhappy. So there was a person called Joseph Breuer, okay? So Joseph Breuer indulged a lot in talk therapy. He used to talk to his patients a lot, okay? And he used to have very long conversations with his patients. And it is during this time that Freud felt that there are so many of our thoughts that basically forms maladaptations in the body and they develop into disorders. Could be mental, could be somatic, or could be bodily disorders. Let's say you are somebody who has always been exploited. Okay, now you were not ever given a chance, or you could not vent it out. So what happened? You kept it within yourself, and then as a bodily manifestation, you got ulcer. And as a psychological manifestation, you got schizophrenia. Now, when Brewer used to talk to his patients a lot, the patients used to tell them about how their childhood was, how their relationship was with their parent or caregiver, when they started feeling this, suffocated, etc., etc. And when Brewer talked to them like, okay, whatever happened in the past, that is past. Why do you think like this? There is some energy, there is some negative energy from those experiences that you have saved somewhere in your stomach, and that has led to an ulcer. So every day in the morning, you drink a glass of water and you feel that the energy is leaving your body. Okay, let's say in the form of urine or whatever, and slowly you will feel better. So when they were using these type of things, then Freud also got an idea that yes, there has to be a lot of talking that needs to be done, because jitne bhi disorders hain, uske seeds are in the unconscious. Uske seeds are in the experiences, the turbulent experiences the person has gone through in the childhood. So I have to first get into those experiences, get into that part of the unconscious of the individual. Only then I can, I can cure this. Okay. So from this psychoanalysis came about, where he's basically analyzing all that is inside your psyche or the mind. Okay, so from there this psychoanalysis came about. Now we had talked about the structure of personality. So first is Freud's psychoanalytic theory is described in three main phases. One is the structure of personality. So again, under structure of personality, we have the topographical model, where we have three consciousness, that is the conscious, pre-conscious or subconscious, and the unconscious that we have discussed. We are not doing it again. Then under that again, we have a dynamic or the structural model, jisme aata hai id, ego, super ego, that also we have done. Now, after that, we come to the Eros and Thanatos, that is the dynamics of personality, that also I told you. Remaining, now next, abhi jo aayega, it is known as psychosexual stages or the psychosexual theory of development. Let me write it down, friends. They have not mentioned this, this topic, but they have explained the topic, but they have not mentioned this word anywhere. So please write it, psychosexual theory of development. Okay, friends, please, in page number 10, where they have written development of personality, usi ke side mein aap please ye likh lo, psychosexual theory of development, because sometimes they might give you this as the heading in the question for the exam, and aapko nahi samajh aayega ki actually yahi cheez likhna tha uske under. Okay, they might just tell you that elaborate the psychosexual theory of development, and they'll not write the थियोरिस्ट नेम कि फ्रॉयड का है कि यूंग का है कि किसका है, और आपको लगेगा पता नहीं कहाँ से आया, कौन से टॉपिक से आया. तो ये जहाँ डेवलपमेंट ऑफ पर्सनालिटी लिखा हुआ है उसको हम साइकोसेक्सुअल डेवलपमेंट में बोलते हैं. ओके, दे हैव गिवन दिस टर्म इन द पैराग्राफ, बट दे हैव नॉट गिवन इट एज अ हेडिंग, सो यू माइट गेट कन्फ्यूज. ओके, पहले फ्रेंड्स हम इसको करेंगे एंड देन वील कम टू द डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म. व्हाट दे हैव डन इज दे हैव गिवन अ रॉन्ग a wrong chronology. They have given the defense mechanism first. Defense mechanism will not come pehle. Pehle this will come. Okay. So now what is psychosexual development? Yaha we have to remember three things. Okay. First, age of the child. Second is the pleasure zone. Third is the activities. Okay. Aap itna yaad rakho. Let me just write it down. Main jaise jaise bolungi, aap chaho to you can take down notes also like that. Age, pleasure zone, and activities. Okay. So friends, first understand, just I told you there is a psychic energy. Similarly, there is a libido in the body. Okay. And आप ऐसे समझो जो libido है that will go from one stage to another. अगर a person completes that stage अच्छे से, if that person completes that stage properly, then it is good for him. But if he does not complete it properly, then he remains fixated at that stage, okay? He remains stuck at that stage. The libido also is stuck at that stage. So nothing happens to the child at that stage. But the manifestations or the consequences of the incompleteness of that stage will actually be seen when the child becomes older or when the child grows up, okay? We'll study. So the number one stage, the first stage is called oral stage, okay? And the age is birth to 18 months. And here the pleasure zone is the mouth, okay? In and around the mouth, or mouth you can say, mouth, teeth, tongue, okay? So here the sexual, please understand, it totally talks about the entire stages are sexual in nature, okay? And it might also seem very strange to you because you will feel ki nahi aisa to nahi hota, I have to never seen a child do this. You might also feel, okay? So understand, these five stages, they totally revolve around the sexual instincts, okay? So here in the oral stage, the focus or the pleasure area is the mouth. So when the child is small, the child is helpless, because the child cannot do anything on his own. So he engages in pleasurable activity in which involves his using his mouth. So he involves in sucking activity. So he's sucking onto the mother's breast for milk. He's sucking his thumb. Whatever object you give him, he'll first suck that. Okay. So these are the activities that he does. So sometimes, what happens, the mother does not let, now this feeding on the mother's milk, for some mothers actually stop it at 3 years or 4 years of the age, and for some children the mothers also allow it for 6 to 7 years, okay? So if this stage is not handled well, or if the child is abruptly stopped from feeding on the mother's milk, feeding on the mother's breast. So what happens is the child will develop fixation because his libido is not completely channelized. Okay, that energy is not completely channelized. So the person develops an oral personality. And this happens if the gratification is too little or too much. Let's say the average age on till which the child should feed on the mother's breast is 5 years. If the child is weaned away or stopped at 3 years, or it is continued till 7 years, now the child will develop an oral personality. So in oral personality, if the child was stopped too early, then the child will become, when the child grows up, he will become too dependent upon others. He'll become very gullible. And also he will become, he'll try to follow everybody. These are the things he will do when he grows up. Also, he might get into smoking, drinking, because that jitni der tak wo oral stimulation hona chahiye tha, wo hua nahi hai. So he's going to compensate that with other activities when he grows up, okay? So again, if he's smoking or if he's drinking alcohol, if he's biting his nails, or if he's abusing people, everywhere he's still using his mouth. So the pleasure zone still remains the same, okay? And these people, agar unko bahut zyada restrict kiya gaya hoga, so these people will also become very pessimistic and very aggressive towards others. Okay, so this was the first stage, also known as the oral stage. In second stage mein, it is known as the anal stage, and it is from 18 months to 3 years. Okay, सो आप ऐसा समझ लो 18 मंथ से 3 इयर्स तक इज द एनल स्टेज, और यहाँ पे जो टॉयलेट ट्रेनिंग होती है बच्चे की, दैट इज डन. ओके, सो द प्लेजर जोन इज व्हाट? द प्लेजर जोन इज यू कैन से द जेनिटल एरिया. ओके, द जेनिटल एरिया और द एरिया फ्रॉम विच ही इज यूरिनेटिंग और ही इज डेफिकेटिंग. ओके, सो द चाइल्ड फील्स वेरी हैप्पी when he is defecating, or let's say he is storing the urine, or he is expelling the urine. And at this time the parent has to be very considerate during the toilet training. So aap bahut baar dekhoge parents become very angry if the child tells that I want to go to the washroom, and there the child will go, he'll start playing with the water, he will not expel the feces, and the mother gets very angry. Mujhe kitna kaam hai, tum kyun hai, ab kyun nahi, why are you not doing potty, this, that. Now this, if this happens, the child becomes very discouraged. Again, the child suffers from fixation. And then what happens, ye jo retention or ye jo retention or control wala jo behavior hai that the child is expected to do during toilet training, that remains fixated, and then that expresses itself in the growing up years. Okay, so the child, if he is fixated, then he turns into an anal personality in his growing up years. And then he, because bachpan mein he was taught to for toilet training, and lot of cleanliness, and lot of timeliness, everything was focused a lot, it should be clean, tumhe is jagah pe hi urine karna hai, not anywhere else, don't mess, yahan wahan mess mat karo, ye mat karo, wo mat karo. So jab child bada hota hai, then the child actually becomes a person who is obsessed with cleanliness, perfection and control. Okay, and if the child has been given very little attention during toilet training, then those children will become very messy and very disorganized. Okay, then coming to the third stage, that is known as the phallic stage. So many people might not have read this word. It's the phallic stage or the phallic stage, however you say it. And this is one of the most important stages in the life of the child. So here, the pleasure zone is the genitals of the child. Okay. So here, basically, I forgot to tell you the age. The age is from 3 to 6. Here, the child starts developing sexual urge or sexual interest, okay, and he plays with his genitals most of the time. Here the jo ladka hai, he is very very proud of his genital, and he always feels that he's superior to a girl because he has a penis which the girl does not have. He starts feeling sexually attracted towards the parent of the opposite gender, towards his mother. Okay, and this is known as the Oedipus complex. Okay, you might have not even heard this word, Oedipus complex. Okay, in Oedipus complex, what happens, the son feels sexually attracted towards the mother, but he knows that it's not easy to get the mother because the father is already there in her life. So what he does, he first tries to revolt against his father, but he knows he cannot match up with the strength of the father. Also, he somehow feels very threatened and very scared that the father might cut down his penis, or he might be castrated. Okay, so the father might cut his genital. So what he does is, he slowly tries to identify with the father later, because he knows that at this age, I don't have the strength to fight with him. Okay, so this is known as the castration anxiety, where the child is suffering from an anxiety that my genital will be cut. So instead of fighting, let me actually reconcile with my father. Okay, also as jaise the son feels for the mother, the daughter also feels for the father, and it is known as Electra complex. But please understand, Electra complex was something Freud never agreed with. It was a concept given by Jung, and Freud actually told that there is nothing like Electra complex, and I have never seen something called as Electra complex. It is basically the Oedipus complex, and it happens with sons only. But Electra complex is also a part of psychosexual stages of development, because later on, some of the psychodynamic theorists told that no, it also the girl also feels this, because they also tend to get attracted to the opposite parent. Okay, now if this stage is passed on well, if the mother and the father are very tolerant and very understanding of the child, then the child does not get fixated at this stage. But let's say the parents are not very tolerant, or let's say are not very cooperative with the child, then the child may get fixated, and a fixation at this stage will result in sexual deviations in the later stages of life, and the child may also have a very weak sexual identity. Okay, also if a child thinks that he has been controlled a lot, and if he has been insulted, or you know, if he has not been, if he has been suppressed a lot, the anger of that he will take out on his partner, okay, or her partner. They will be very careless partners, they'll be very cruel partners, they would be very taunting kind of people, they'll do that to their partners. So at this follic stage, if it is not resolved, those things will actually manifest in their sexual tendencies towards their partners. Okay, so this is the follic stage. Then friends, we come to the latency stage, that is from age 6 to puberty. So after all this happens, the child, now he understands. See, till the age of 6, the child is with the family. Okay, so everything here is going on with the father, mother, toilet training with the mother, let's say oral pleasure, everything with the mother, father, whoever. Now understand that after 6, the child now goes to school, so he has very less time to spend with his parents or caregivers now. So here comes the latency stage, when his sexual urges or sexual motives, they get hidden. Okay, they're latent, chup jate hain. Now what happens, the jitne bhi uske sexual aggressive urges hote hain, they are channelized into more socially acceptable substitutes. So now the child will play with mostly the same sex peers or friends of his. Okay, the child will be more comfortable with his own friends of his own gender. After that, last is the genital stage, puberty to the end of life. Now here what happens, here the actual sexual drives or motives, they become activated. The child, the person gets married off, the person gets into a relationship, the person actually manifests his sexual wishes and desires with his partner, and then it continues. Okay, so these were the 5 stages of psychosexual development. Please go through it once, and after this we come to the defense mechanism. Now what is defense mechanism? See, defense mechanism is due to fixation, also due to anxiety in the external world, there is a lot of conflict that goes on in the mind. Okay, there is always the mismatch of ego and superego and the id. Okay, when it is one, it is trying to say something, the ego is not allowing, the superego is not allowing. So what the person does is, he has developed certain defense mechanism, or he has developed certain mechanisms which allow him to withstand this harshness of the society. Okay, so the first defense mechanism is denial. So let's say a mother has lost her son. It is an irreparable loss. The mother knows that the son is not there anymore, and she's suffering from a lot of pain. How she's going to control herself? Instead of facing the reality, she starts to deny the fact. She says that no, nothing has happened. Who told that my son is no more? Wo to so raha hai. He's just sleeping. He'll get up after some time. You might have seen this, okay? You might have seen this in movies also around you. So this is denial, when you are basically saying that this does not exist. So this is a defense mechanism. For some days, for some hours, at least it keeps you strong. It keeps you happy. Okay. Many a times you will see there are some people who are into a relationship for 10, 12 years, and then this relationship breaks, or let's say the person, one of the partner gets married somewhere else, and the person who's left behind, उसको उसके सारे फ्रेंड समझाते हैं, लीव इट यार, ही नो ही इज ऑलरेडी मैरिड, उसको भूल जाओ, या फिर यू नो मे बी ही नेवर लव्ड यू विद दैट इंटेंसिटी एज यू डिड, बट दिस पर्सन इज ऑलवेज इन डिनायल, नहीं नहीं इट्स नॉट लाइक दैट, ही लव्स मी बट ही हैड टू चूज समथिंग एल्स एंड आई कैन नॉट लव एनीबडी एल्स बिकॉज यू नो द लव दैट वी हैव दैट विल ब्रेक एंड आई लिव विद द मेमोरीज, ये वो, दीज आर सम सॉर्ट्स ऑफ डिनायल, ये आप करते हो सो दैट दिस ब्रिंग्स मोर पीस टू यू. ओके, then second is repression that I have already told you, whatever is very troubling for you, very hurtful for you or very disturbing for you, aap jaan boojh ke deliberately usko apne unconscious mein push kar dete ho so that you feel peace at yourself. Then next is regression. So regression is where you yourself are moving back into a previous stage. So you please just remember when you were a child and you wanted to have something एंड अगर आपको वो ना दिया जाए सो आप बहुत ओवरटली रोते थे, सर वर यू नो सर हाथ पैर इधर उधर पटक के एंड समटाइम्स थ्रोइंग थिंग्स, लेकिन जब आप बड़े हुए वेन एवर यू फेल्ट वेरी पेनफुल यू क्राइड इन साइलेंस, यू क्राइड इन लोनलीनेस, ओके, यू डिडंट वॉन्ट एनीबडी टू सी यू. बट रिग्रेशन क्या होता है, दैट दैट प्रॉब्लम और दैट एंग्जाइटी इज सो बिग फॉर यू that you no more can remain in the same state, you actually regress back, you actually go back and you start behaving like a child because that gives you more expression. Okay, so that is regression. Next is reaction formation. Reaction formation is just to hide your true feelings, you try and show excessive behavior. Matlab, just say, let's say a stepmother does not like her step daughter, but just to show in front of everybody she takes extra care of her. Okay, so this is reaction formation. You just want to show extra behavior to cover up your real feelings. Then next is projection. So this is projection is you are a liar and you tell everybody that no, actually I am a good person in our friendship, but my friend is a liar, therefore I am behaving like this. So you are projecting your own flaws to somebody else. The next is rationalization. Rationalization is you have done a mistake and that is giving you a lot of anxiety. So what you do is you use a lot of explanation and everything and you try to justify that behavior. So let's say you have failed in the exams and your mother asks you that why did you fail? So you don't tell that you didn't study. Rather, you say, "Arey, the question paper was so tough. Arey, pata hai, jis room mein we were having the exam, wahan fan hi nahi tha. Main raat bhar nahi soya tha, and I was feeling, you know, I have got migraine. Isiliye I couldn't pass." So you're trying to justify it. Okay, so that is rationalization. Then is intellectualization. What is intellectualization? Here, what happens? All the feelings that you have, you turn them into your expertise or you turn them into a thought. Like let's say you find that you have any life-threatening disease like cancer, so to deal with it you don't want to become sad and you know you don't want to exaggerate that situation, rather you study about cancer so much that you become an expert. So whenever people talk about cancer you get a feeling of fulfillment because you know so much about it and people are consulting you for it. Okay, so that is intellectualization. Then is displacement. What is displacement? Displacement is suppose somebody has hurt you or somebody has hit you and you also want to hit back, but you know that the person is powerful and you can't do it, so you search for a softer target and then you do the same thing to that person what has been done to you. So basically it is दूसरे का गुस्सा किसी और पे निकालना, बिकॉज आप उस इंसान पे नहीं निकाल सकते, बिकॉज दैट पर्सन इज स्ट्रॉन्गर. सो व्हाट हैपेंस, सपोज इन द ऑफिस द बॉस स्कोल्ड्स योर फादर, द फादर कैन स्कोल्ड द बॉस, सो द फादर कम्स होम एंड स्कोल्ड्स द चाइल्ड, बिकॉज द चाइल्ड इज अ सॉफ्टर टारगेट, द चाइल्ड कैन नॉट डू एनीथिंग, इवन इफ द फादर हैज स्कोल्डेड द चाइल्ड एंड द चाइल्ड रिप्लाइज बैक, देन द फादर विल जस्ट यू नो गिव अ स्लैप और समथिंग एंड द चाइल्ड हैज टू बी क्वाइट. So this is displacement. Whatever has happened to you, you do that to somebody else because that person is weaker and that person is a soft target. Okay. And last is the sublimation. Last defense mechanism is sublimation. This is the only defense mechanism which is positive. And what is sublimation? You have gone, this is sublimation. If you have to understand, it is the film Rockstar. That is an example of sublimation. So much wrong, so much pain, so much hurt you have gone through, and you have channelized that into something productive. You have channelized that into something creative. So in that movie, you will see they also, that movie entirely is on this thought only. Ki agar tumhe koi dard nahi hoga, to you will not be able to produce any masterpiece. So he has this lifelong pain that it is due to him that the person he loved the most is no more. So with that pain, with that guilt, comes out the most beautiful expression in forms of songs. Okay. So that is sublimation. Now, this is done. The psychoanalysis theory is done. We'll quickly go through evaluation of Freud's theory and we'll finish the class today. Tomorrow, we will do Karen Horney and Sullivan. Again, these two are also very important. Please attend tomorrow's class because these two, again, are very important chapters in terms of counseling and clinical psychology. So do attend this, okay? Now, what is the next? We'll go through the evaluation of Freud's theory. So what are the merits? So merits of the theory are that it is a complete theory of personality. It explains behavior. It also emphasizes the role of unconscious and early childhood experiences. It emphasizes dynamic nature of behavior. Okay. And it talks of defense mechanism too. Okay. How people use defense mechanism to save themselves. And it also gives a sound framework, or let's say a very strong foundation for psychological treatment of mental disorders. Okay. But still, there are some demerits in it. Number one, it lacks in empirical evidences. And many people also believe that Freud's clinical data is flawed, inaccurate, and it is very selective. He has taken those case studies which is very convenient for him. This is what some of the critics say. Also, some of the techniques used by him, like interpretation of dreams, the role of free association, etc., have been criticized because their interpretations are not similar across all the theorists. Okay, every theorist will interpret in a different way. Then some techniques are poorly designed. There is not a lot of scientific data in them. The role of environment is overlooked. Basically, everything, major focus is on unconscious, and they're not talking about context and environment, etc. There is overemphasis on sexual drive, and they have not talked about free will, choice, etc. of human beings, and they have talked more of a very mechanistic way that if this happens, this will also happen. If the person has suffered from this, then this is the defense mechanism he'll use. Okay. So these were some of the demerits. So with this, we finish this portion of Freud's theory. Tomorrow we'll do Karen Horney theory and the theory of Sullivan. So please join at 6 or 6:15. I'll intimate the time in the group. So thank you, everybody. If there's any doubt, you can reach out to me. So if there's any doubt, we'll take up now. Otherwise, we'll meet tomorrow.
Ma'am?
Yes.
How successful was psychosexual development, Freud's psychosexual development? How successful was it?
No, it is not about being successful. It is just a theory that they have put forward. And it is just, we observe that these are certain things or certain aspects in personality that is observed in the later years. This was not like a test or something where we are scoring. So if we are scoring, we can see the success. That is exactly where the demerit comes, that these are not scientific because they don't have any empirical evidence. We have not quantified that, okay, this suppose the person had to achieve 60%, the person has achieved 30, so there is a fixation of 30%, and hence he shows a 30% of deviant behavior. It is not measured in these quantified terms. So that is why we cannot say it is successful, and because there is no scientific evidence, we can only say that these are observable personality patterns which when correlated with the childhood experiences of the same individual, they do show a pattern, or they do show that yes, this has been true. Like, let's say somebody is smoking a lot, and then while you are talking to them during the free association, you ask them how your childhood has been. Suppose he says that my childhood, oh, it has not been very good because my mother, she was a working woman. So actually I didn't, I have not been fed much of mother's milk. Let's say I had a caretaker who used to give me this Amul milk, or let's say milk powder wala milk. So what you have done is you're basically going back and tracing those causes from which you can know that this theory, whatever is saying, is true or false to some extent. But we cannot quantify its success through any measurement or any unit.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, do we use this, like if we go for therapy, so do, like, you know, in therapy sessions, is it commonly been used?
Yes, it is used, because when you see, first of all, there is no such therapy which uses only one kind of technique. Okay, we are not just using behavioral technique, we are not using just psychoanalysis. Basically, it is an eclectic approach where we are taking the best out of all therapies and then we are using it on the person. So while we are talking to a person, and see, how actually will you know that this has to be used? When you are in a session, suppose the person, he's sitting next to you and his hands and his fingers start trembling. And then you ask him, why are your fingers trembling? Is there any medical cause or what? And suppose the person says, no, actually, I had never told you, but I'm basically a chain smoker. And if I don't smoke every 30, 45 minutes, this is what happens. Oh, okay. So when did you start smoking? Oh, maybe I started smoking when I was 18, 19 years old. Okay. And why was it like this? It was because of your peers or whatever. So this is the route how we go back and how we can trace it. Okay. This is how this theory is useful. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, most welcome. So, okay. Okay. I assume there are no more doubts. We'll meet tomorrow then. I'll share the time in the group. Thank you, everybody. Take care. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.